Once upon a time, an eaglet fell from its nest. A farmer working in the field saw this baby eagle laying on the ground, and he picked it up, took it home to nurse it back to health. Some time passed, and a naturalist was going through the area, and he saw this huge eagle with his farmer's chickens. So he ran up to the farmer's house, he knocked on the door, and he said, "Farmer, there's an eagle with your chickens." And the farmer said, "That's not an eagle, that's a chicken." And the naturalist said, "I have a college degree. I know the difference between an eagle and a chicken. There's an eagle with your chickens." And the farmer said, "No, he thinks he's a chicken, so he's a chicken." The naturalist said, "Well, that's crazy." So the farmer took him out, and sure enough, this baby eagle scratching and pecking with the chickens. And the naturalist said, "Let me show him he's an eagle." And the farmer said, "Go ahead." So the naturalist picked the eagle up, looked in the eagle's eye, and he said, "Eagle, thou art an eagle." And he threw him up in the air. And the eagle just fluttered around, saw the chickens, and went back and started scratching and pecking with the chickens again. And the naturalist said, or the farmer said, "See, I told you, he thinks he's a chicken, so he's a chicken." And the naturalist said, "Let me have another chance." And the farmer said, "Well, go ahead." So this time the naturalist carried the eagle to the top of the farmhouse, looked at the eagle and said, "Eagle, thou art an eagle, fly," and threw him off the roof of the house. And the eagle just kind of fluttered around, saw the different chickens, and went back and started scratching and pecking with the chickens again. And the farmer said, "See, I told you, he thinks he's a chicken, so he's a chicken." And the naturalist said, "Let me have one more chance." And the farmer said, "Go ahead." So this time the naturalist got up before the sun rose, drove out to the top of a mountain, and as the sun was coming up, he grabbed the eagle by the beak, looked the eagle in the eye, and he said, "Eagle, thou art an eagle. Unfold thy wings and fly," and he threw him off the cliff. And the eagle kind of fluttered around looking for the chickens, but he couldn't see them. And then he looked into the sun, and he unfolded his wings, and he flew. Now, that's not my story, by the way. I heard that story the first time when I was just beginning college, but it really touched me. The first time I heard it, I thought, "Man, I'm an eagle." But as I've gone through life, what I've discovered is I'm actually the naturalist. And what I do is I try to help other people see the eagle that's within them. And that's what my writing is all about. That's what I try to accomplish. Now, that story inspired the first poem that I ever had published, which is called Soar High. And it's one that I've carried with me. It's the only poem I ever memorized. I found out that if I memorize my poetry, I keep writing the same poem over and over again. And so Soar High I memorized, and I've carried it with me because it's been really meaningful to me. And when I decided to write this second book, it just made sense for it to be about this poem. And it goes, "Soar high, my well-loved friend, and fly without fear. If you should ever need me, just call and I'll be near. But remember, the skies are not made for those afraid to fly, nor dreams for those afraid to live. So unfold your wings, dream your dreams, and give life all you have to give." A few years back, I had a publisher approach me, and they wanted to do a collection of my poems. And I started putting my poems together. I realized that there was a message that I hadn't seen before. And I ended up adding some of my essays, some of my columns to it, and published my first book, which was the Spirit of the Horse and other works. And I realized that what I was doing is I was talking about this journey that we go on. And as I, after that book was published, and I decided to come up with the second one, I had more of the intent in mind of following that pattern of learning to find out who we truly are. In my case, finding out that I'm the naturalist, and it's okay to be the naturalist. Other people can be eagles. To find out who around me are eagles that are really needing to unfold their wings. And even sometimes realizing that the chickens are okay because they're really chickens. And they're being authentic and being chickens. And so I started working on my second book, and as I was going through this process and writing my poetry, I started realizing that it wasn't all about positive things, happy things. And I began to spend a little bit more time talking about some of the challenges that we face as we go through life. And as I did, more things started to come together for me. My poetry is the most personal thing I write. And I write columns for the newspaper, I write essays, I've written a couple of stories, but when it comes to my poetry, that's where I'm writing really deep down inside. And sometimes it's difficult. Sometimes we're dealing with things that are kind of scary, sometimes we're dealing with things that are real happy. But then when I started putting them all together, I realized that I didn't feel like I was alone anymore. I started writing my poetry, I started publishing it for people, and I thought, I'm writing about my own personal truth, and that might not be the same truth for other people. But then I started having people come back and say, wow, I'm glad you wrote about that. I'm glad you talked about that. So, and by the way, the story of the eagle is in this book, and I give credit to the person who actually wrote the story. When I first heard it, it wasn't attributed to the author. It took me 20 years to find out who actually wrote the story. Anyway. Oh, that's going to be fun. Okay, so, okay.
Move it down a little bit.
Move it?
Move your, yeah.
How's that?
That's better.
Better, okay, good. So, I've been told that people no longer read long poems, and I think that's kind of sad. I've noticed that when I'm submitting poems, they all have a line short, and when you start writing a poem to fit a certain number of lines, then sometimes the message gets lost. And I started thinking, well, no, I understand that. I will try to live, but sometimes I don't do so well in living according to that. So one of the things that I did is I decided I'm going to write a long poem for my book. So the first poem in my book is actually kind of The first poem in my book is kind of a autobiographical poem, and it talks about different things that I've had to go through in my life. And so, and at the first, it's kind of fun just talking about my experience in when I was born. Kind of a funny story. My father and his best friend worked at the Perlite Mill out by Antonito, and they got off work, and my father's best friend, Warren, wanted to go have a beer. And Dad kind of had an idea it wasn't a good thing to do because Mom was like 9 months pregnant and getting really close to the time. So when they got to the place, to Romeo, Warren went in for the beer and my dad stole his car. So Warren got mad And he went and stole his car back, and he flattened the tires on my dad's car. Then mom went into labor, and as it will happen in Colorado sometimes, we had a spring blizzard. I was born in April, but there was an actual blizzard. And at that time, the closest hospital was Alamosa. We lived in Manassas, so it's 24 miles driving through the snow. Dad went out, the tires were flat, and so he stole Warren's car back. And drove to the hospital, let mom off, and said, I need to take the car back, because he didn't want to get arrested. So he went to take the car back to Warren, and I was born. And much to my parents' surprise, I was a boy. They had planned on having a daughter, and so they had all these girls' names picked out. So when I was born, mom had no idea what to name me. And the nurse came in and asked her and was kind of pushing her a little bit. So mom grabbed Gideon's Bible and opened it up and gave me the first name that she saw, which was Philip. Which is really kind of cool, because Philip means lover of horses. And as I've gone through my life, I've had horses. Whenever there's been a big dramatic change, horses have come into it. Anyway, so those are really cool things. Mom loved me. And, you know, one of the things I write about is how children seem to have a better idea of what life's all about than we do. It's like we start off, we have this pure innocence. We don't know that there are some people we're not supposed to love. We just love everybody. We don't know that there are some things that we can't do. We believe we can do anything. And so we start off with that wonderful freedom of spirit, and then things start happening to us. And so in my longer poem, I have this one section that I call Early Heartbreak. Okay? Even in my immaturity, I could see she was beautiful. Dark hair, brown eyes that sparkled when she smiled, innocent face, sweeter than the song, innocent voice, sweeter than the song of birds. The mere mention of her name made my heart flutter, so I said it again and again, hoping the wind would carry the news of my love to her heart. We met in school. She made kindergarten a daily adventure, filled with excitement and hope. Maybe someday she would know. Maybe feel the same. Maybe we could find happiness together. And then it happened. Somehow she heard the news. I was walking to the store when I saw her laughing with a circle of friends. She saw me. Eyes connect. My heart stopped, stumbled, then beat again. She approached, smiled, said, I heard you love me. Is that true? I stammer, blush, force out my confession. Yes, it's true. I do love you. Oh, that's gross, she said. Screamed, runs laughing with her friends, carrying my confidence away. For the first time, I learn a pain, rejection, disappointment. In a brief, simple moment, I discover self-doubt, soon to become rooted deep within my soul, and the spirit of can't is born. So, it was one of those moments where, if that would have been the only thing that happened, then maybe it wouldn't have been such a big thing. But I started to believe that I wasn't worthy, and I started to have those doubts. And as I started to have those feelings, that spirit of can't started growing and becoming bigger and bigger within me. This poem is also took place when I was young, but there was a part of it that was a surprise to me that I didn't realize until much later the significance of it. Forced to be free. Memories swirl through my mind, images carrying smiles and tears, comfort and fears. Dad driving to Crestone, Mom at his side, Kelvin, Glenda, Sandra, and I in the back seat. Or had Sandra not been born yet? I hunkered down in the floor of the car and began to sing songs from the old stereo Dad had found in the country landfill, brought home, repaired, dusty old recordings. Lazy River by Louis Armstrong. Hank Williams wailing, I'm so lonesome I could cry. The Page Kavanaugh Trio singing about the Three Bears. Love of music, of jazz and blues. Born by chance because of records discarded by someone who didn't know their value. Family gathered for Thanksgiving dinners. Children fed first, sent in separate rooms, adults feast on fellowship, both tables filled with food, city block flooded by fire department, water frozen overnight, children gathered the next morning to skate. You can't skate here, this ain't for jacks. I slink home, second, or weirdly third, hand skates, slung over slunken shoulders. They stand at the front door, no way to get around them. There he is, one shouts, hard fist pounding on soft flesh, rejection slashing through my soul to my heart. The river's more fun anyway. Best friend announces, picks up skates, leads the way. We follow country streams, freely through low hills of beaver ponds and seagull springs, and those who belong skate in tired circles, ever vigilant to make sure those who don't belong are forced to find freedom. So one of the things that happens, and I didn't realize it until years later, was by not being accepted by the group, it actually pushed me to where I could do things on my own. And I had that freedom. When I started going through this, I started looking at some of the... You like to think that once you discover where you're going to go, that things are going to be easy, going to be simple for you. But my experience has been life doesn't let up on you. Bad things happen. This has been, to be perfectly honest about it, this has been a rough year for me. Let's just say that I've become a lot more familiar with how to deal with grief than I ever wanted to be. A few years ago, I was living up in the cabin up in South Fork. There was a fire burning around us, but I was pretty sure that the fire wasn't going to come all the way into town, so I was staying up there. But, you know, people like to talk, and stories get built bigger and bigger and bigger. And so everybody was saying, oh, they've evacuated South Fork. And I said, well, they left me here, you know. And one day I got a phone call from my brother. And he said, I'm on my way. I'm going to get there as soon as I can. I'm going to do everything I can to help. Oh, Kelvin, don't worry about it. Fire's over 20 miles away. Everything's okay. And he got real quiet. He said, you haven't heard. And I said, heard what? Devin died in a car wreck. Well, Devin was my sister's oldest son, and so that's heartbreaking. But he was also one of the few people who could tell when I was going into that dark place. You get really good at hiding that from people, you know, and you smile and you wave, and then you go and you lock yourself alone and don't let anybody in. And he was the one who would always call and say, "Hey, Uncle Phil, let's go do karaoke." And next thing I know, we'd be talking about life, and everything would just be wonderful. And so when he left, he took a part of me along with him. And then the next day, was evacuated and had to leave the cabin. And I went to stay with my parents, and my sister and brother-in-law, that put us at just enough of a distance. They live in Delnor, my parents live in Manassas. Really not that far away, but when things like that's going on, that's far enough to where you don't get to see each other. And we really struggled to deal with that. And then I had somebody come up to me and they said, "You know, maybe this is part of God's plan. He brought you here from Seattle and then had you driven from the fire, from the cabin by the fire, so you could be here with your parents." And I discovered something that I hadn't really thought about before, and that's that anger is a real strong part of grief. And as soon as they said that, boy, the anger came back. And I said, "You know, if God did this, if God destroyed my life in Seattle to force me to come here, if God built this fire that's destroying so many acres of woods just to make me come live with my parents so he could take this precious spirit away from us, then God's a jerk." And it took me a while to kind of come to grips with understanding that no matter what, there are those losses that we have in our life. And accepting the darkness that comes with that without living in it, without having it become so much a part of our lives. Finding ways to be true, to be honest, and acknowledge that darkness is there, but also be able to see the light. You look at a beautiful sunrise and you see all kinds of shadows. Well, those shadows are the darkness, right? But you also see this wonderful light that's showing through. And being able to see the whole picture is where you really find the deeper meaning. I mentioned earlier that horses have really been an important part of my life. And so as we were going through this, a couple of things happened. One of them involved my brother-in-law. One of them involved my sister. And then a good friend of mine shared some of the things that happened to him. And so I wrote this poem called Horse Whispers. And I should warn you, this one and a couple of the poems, to be quite honest, I have a hard time getting through them without breaking down a little bit. So if I get kind of misty, forgive me, bear with me. But I like them, so I'm going to share them with you. The exhausted cowboy leads his horses away from the flames, each step shooting pain through grief-troubled bones. He fought to get out of bed, struggled to face another day, wanted to give up, to just turn away, but somehow, he found the courage to put one foot in front of the other. The fire forced him to set his pain aside, going to take care of the horses. He rolled until his aching back forced him to walk, leading them to safety. He thought he couldn't take one more step. Then Rose slipped her head under his arm, almost lifting him off of his feet. He led, leaning on her, and made it through another day. Horses whisper to our souls, lift our spirits when we are weary, give comfort when we are troubled. carry us through our fears and doubts. They let us know we are loved. When we don't feel worthy, they give us their trust. When we can't trust ourselves, they carry us through our fears. When courage threatens to abandon us, horses lead us to the best within us. They came to comfort the cowgirl, but she ended up comforting them. That was always her way. She wept in private, stood strong in public, admired by those who depended on her. She couldn't reach out, she didn't know how. Trying to hide her pain, she drove out to the field, ran her fingers through midnight's curly mane, looked into the horse's eyes, and heard the whisper, "There are no words, just trust and understanding." She buried her face in midnight's neck and weeps. Horses whisper to our souls, lift our spirits when we are weary, give comfort when we are troubled, carry us through our fears and doubts. They let us know that we are loved when we don't feel worthy. Give us their trust when we don't trust ourselves. Carry us through our doubts and fears when courage threatens to abandon us. Horses lead us to the best within us. Sunset's softened features sparkle as the veteran dropped his marine tough outer armor to reveal a broken heart. "She died in my arms," he said, "and there was nothing I could do to stop it." Quietly, the stallion in the pen slips his head over the fence and rested on the soldier's shoulder. The Marine slips his arm around the horse's neck, hugs him for a moment, pats his soft coat. "I don't know what I'd do if I didn't have the horses." Horses whisper to our souls, lift our spirits when we are weary, give comfort when we are troubled, carry us through our fears and doubts. They let us know we are loved when we don't feel worthy, give us their trust when we can't trust ourselves, carry us through our fears when courage threatens to abandon us. Horses lead us to the best within us. Now this poem isn't in the book. It's one that I wrote recently, but it kind of goes along with this. The three stories in that poem, the first two are about my brother-in-law and my sister when they lost their son. The third one is about a good friend of mine who's working with the rescue, the horse rescue I work with, to reach out to veterans, and it's kind of why he thinks that's such an important thing. This last summer, I should say, I lost my sister several years ago, and her kids live in Montana. Once a year they come down to Colorado to the Manassas Pioneer Days, and we all get together and we get to see each other. On July 4th this year, we lost one of my nephews. A 16-year-old kid got hit by a truck. And it was totally, you can't expect that. You can't prepare for that. It just, it happens. Yeah. And I was working for the newspaper, riding on the concert train, getting ready to go spend a wonderful day up in the mountains. And I lose my phone signal just about the time the train hits Blanca. So when we were going up, I got the first message that said, "Jesse got hit by a truck." And it wasn't until the end of the day when I was coming back that I got the last message that we had left him. It was so tough. And I wish that I could believe that I'm done with grief. Enough is enough. But then we always have, and it's not only grief at the loss of somebody because they lose their lives, but sometimes we get that relationship maybe, and it doesn't work out the way we wanted, and we find ourselves grieving because of that. Or sometimes we lose that job that we want, and we find ourselves grieving because of that. Or sometimes we lose that friendship. Or there's so many different losses that we end up having to face in our life and deal with grief. So I wrote this poem just a couple weeks ago. It's called, I guess it's been a few weeks. Anyway, not too long ago. It's called Grief. Grief is a tidal wave of emotions dashing the soul against rocky cliffs of despair. With every beat of your broken heart, and you try not to breathe because each breath adds to the icy grip of sorrow, fear, anger, and guilt that squeeze your heart until it feels as though it will explode. Thoughts are a cyclone that refuses to be silenced when all you want is silence. To not think anything, to not feel anything. But you can't stop thinking and you can't stop feeling, and family and friends try to console you by telling you it's time to move on, it's time to let go, it's part of a plan, and you want to scream because you want to move on, you want to let go, but the plan sucks, and the tidal wave slams into you again and again. The road before you is so steep, you stretch your hands in front of your face and feel the craggy cliffs. And sometimes it feels like you can't take another step. All you can do is breathe. So you do. And then you breathe again. And you just keep breathing until you can take that step. And then another. It never goes away. But we learn how to breathe again. How to crawl again. How to walk again, and if we're lucky, we learn how to dream again. To dream of a day when there will again be room in our hearts, even amidst the pain, for joy to return. But today, it's all I can do to keep from being destroyed. So, it might sound like I'm really a depressed guy, but the good news is those are the shadows, and there's also the light that we have. And so I'm gonna end by sharing a couple of little bit more hopeful poems. One of the things that I found is nature is really healing. I live in a small little shack on the edge of town. I'm the last house at the end of the road. And I wake up every morning and I see the mountain. And there's nothing between the mountain and I except for miles and miles of prairie. And one day I went exploring and I found this little pond at the base of the mountain. And so I wrote a poem about the pond. Dusty gravel road leads through rabbit brush and sage. Over arid prairie rises and down gentle slopes, the gravel road becomes a dirt road while we drive. My mind ventures back to a time before there were roads and signs to mark the way. The first to enter the valley saw the mountain, felt its spirit, and believed all life began here. Next came explorers, some overwhelmed by the emptiness of this arid land stretched a fork in the mountain peaks. The San Juans to the west, the Sangre de Cristos to the east, and Mount Blanca rising from the dry desert floor. The precious gift of water, giver and sustainer of life, rare in this desert land. We round one turn, one small alkali ponds, outlined by white circles, making them unfit for drinking. We round another corner, and there it is. him from sight among the brush, the emptiness of the prairie, the large pond filled with ducks and geese resting in the water, occasionally diving for a flash of fish. I stand on the bank contemplating the mountain's reflection in the water, which proclaims this is a place of life. I wonder how many have stood at this spot, feeling that their search for new beginnings has reached its end. As I was writing that longer poem, my autobiography, and by the way, I named it A Poem Yet to Be Written, because my life isn't done, and I'm still making discoveries. But this is probably, as I was going through all of this stuff, the epiphany that kind of pulled me out of the darkness. And, you know, life has its challenges, but somehow we have to find a way to get through. And so this is how the long poem ends. It's called Section 3, The Awakening, The Whisper. The spirit of Kant whispers until ignored. Then the whisper becomes louder while darkness rages around me. I have to try, I scream. You'll only be hurt, the spirit of Kant moans. But I have to at least try. You're not worthy, the spirit of Kant wails. Panic rages within while the winds cry in the emptiness of the prairie. I stand on the brink of despair and scream into the darkness, who am I? The answer comes as a soft whisper from the foundation of my soul. You are love. Thank you. So, anybody have any questions? In my classes, I have this little routine that I do at the beginning of each class. I go, questions, comment, because sometimes as teachers will ask students, do you have a question? And they're sitting, their minds haven't quite changed from I'm taking in information to now I get to say something. And it takes them a little while to shift gears. And I found that if I go, are there any questions? That's when they go, oh crud, what do I do now? Comments? Oh, I'm supposed to say something. Concerns? Oh yeah, I'm concerned. And then I end with criticism, and every time I get to criticism, all the hands go up. unfortunately, usually it's quite, although criticism does come in. So, any questions? Comments? Concerns? Oh, yeah.
Can you talk about your creative process? Do you find yourself sitting down to write at certain times of the day, and do you write completely one poem before you go back and edit it, or do you kind of go a little bit at a time?
Yes. and that's funny, because one of the things I'll tell my students is you can write any time, but you should pick one time of the day that's set aside for writing. Now, that's not the only time you can write, but during that time, that's when you spend writing. And I discovered how important that is. Dr. Cole Foster is sitting here, and he's the one, first one who said that that's an important thing to do. And like most college students, I went, yeah, right, okay, whatever. But I was married, and my oldest child was about 7 or 8 months old, and my wife was pregnant with our second child, which by the way, I should say ex-wife, and that's part of the reason for it, but she wasn't real happy about some of the choices I made, I guess. Anyway, I told her that I would take care of the kid, because I'm usually pretty busy, and I could tell that she was getting really frustrated. And saw a counselor, and the counselor said, you better do something about this. So I went and said, okay, I'll take care of the kid at night, because I'm smart, right? I'm going to do it while the kid's asleep, because that's going to be a piece of cake. Yeah, all the women in here are going, oh, yeah, you idiot. Yeah, exactly, that's it. I remember the first day that kid slept till 4 o'clock in the morning. And she woke up crying, and I went, oh, good, wait. I actually got 4 hours of sleep. How'd that happen? You know, and I got up, and I fed her, and I put her down, and I could have gone back to bed, but I would have only had about an hour and a half of sleep, and that's not enough time for me to really. So I started writing, and now that kid is like 28 years old, and at 4 o'clock in the morning, my eyes are open, and I can't sleep unless I get up and write something. And so finding a time to write, you kind of train. I like to think that my muse is a big fat elephant that sits in this easy chair with a cigar in one hand and a glass of whiskey in the other, and he doesn't want to move. And you have to find different ways to, but if you ignore him, you'll be walking down the street and he'll come up behind you with a baseball bat. Bam! And if you don't have a piece of paper to write it down, you're in trouble because it's going to be gone. You know. So I've learned to carry a piece of paper around with, but I've also learned to kind of nourish my muse. And writing at the same time every day, he may be kind of reluctant, but he sets down the cigar and sets down the whiskey and says, okay, let's get this done so I can go back to watching TV or whatever it is that they do. So that's part of the process, picking a time every day. I don't make an outline for the things that I write, or at least I used to believe I didn't make an outline for the things that I write, because what I do is I do a real rough draft, and then I go back and I start working with it. And the interesting thing is I start out by taking the stuff that doesn't belong, because we have to get started, and so we spend a little bit of time writing. Okay, I know I want to write something, I know I want to say something, and so I'm going to put in a bunch of hogwash here until I get started, and then we start saying what we want to say. And so I go on and I take out that first part, and then I go back and I take out the last part, and I start working with the middle part, and then I start building from there. Very, very seldom have I ever sat down and written a poem in one sitting, but it has happened. The columns that I write for the newspaper, that happens a lot more frequently than I want to admit, because I have a column that I need to turn in tomorrow morning. I haven't started it yet because I stressed about something else for some reason tonight. So that's going to be a real hammer it out. So sometimes that works, but my best stuff takes time. Something else that's really fascinating, I used to hate revision. It's just a bunch of extra work. For those of you who are aspiring writers, you are robbing yourself of a wonderful experience if you're not revising your work. Because revision is when things happen that you didn't expect. I remember one time my ex was walking by while I was typing on the computer, and I said, damn it, why'd you do that? And she goes, what'd I do? And I said, no, not you, this character in this story I'm writing. Well, wait a second. It's doing what you're telling them to do. Well, there's a point where they quit doing what you're telling them to do. And they start doing the things that you don't want them to do. And when I write poetry, sometimes I just, something may be bothering me, or maybe it's a celebration, and I start throwing the word, and as the words start coming down, and I go back and I start revising and taking out the stuff that doesn't belong and trying to build up the stuff that does, somewhere in that process, understanding takes place. And there's a lesson in this experience. And if I didn't take the time to go through that process, a lot of times, you know, how many times do you have to do the same thing over and over again before you finally learn the lesson? Well, since I started writing about it more and revising more, I don't have to go through that stuff so much. I figure it out a lot faster. Any other questions? Comments? Concerns? Criticism?
Question. Do you retain the rights to the columns you have in the paper?
Yes, I do. Yes, I do. That was part of the agreement that we had. They get the right for the first publishing, and then after that I can do with it what I want. The same with my photographs. I started combining my photography with my poems because it's really hard to get people to read poetry nowadays, especially if you don't put it to music. If you put it to music, you can hopefully get a number one bestseller. But it's really hard to get people to read poetry. So I started taking lines from my poems and putting them with photographs. And I started making these posters. And it's kind of funny because my posters have been doing pretty good. My poetry, a lot of people are reading it, but nobody's paying for it. So, you know, one of the joys of being a poet. It's kind of like being a teacher. Oh, I do that too. Crud, you'd think I'd learn. Sorry. Cool.
Question, though. Has the poem, when you write it down, been revised a million times already?
In my head?
Yeah.
I try not to do that so much.
Really?
But it does happen. Yeah, it does happen. One of the things that I found is until I get it on paper, I'm risking losing it. And so I read an article, and I wish I could remember who I to credit this to, but she said that ideas come from the top of the mountain, and they come rolling down. And if you're lucky, you're in the path, and it'll hit you. But if you don't do something with it, it'll go on to the next person. And I thought, how many times have I read something that somebody's written, and I thought, I could have written that, you know. Well, what happened was I let it stay up there too long. And so I get it on paper as quickly as I can. But yeah, yeah.
You write every day, obviously.
Oh, yes. Yes, I do. I do. And part of that is habit, and part of it is force, and part of it's because every once in a while I like to be able to go to McDonald's and get a cheeseburger. So, yeah. No, I do. I write every day. I don't know what I'd do if I couldn't. I think I might be trapped in my own head if I didn't get it out on paper.
So writing chose you.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. Had some help from a good college professor, though. And by the way, for those who don't know, Dr. Foster taught creative writing and other classes at Adams State for years, and to a great extent, he's kind of responsible for me being here. So he'll take the criticism, and I'll take the praise. Okay. I wasn't going to do it, but I got to get that little thing I said about taking out the first third. And say, that was him. He's the one who taught me that. And it works really, really well. It works really well. You really get down to the stuff you want to say. And it's funny how much time, you know, that voice of Kant, Paulo Coelho talks about this liar that's within us. And it's funny because I had always been taught that you should listen to what's inside, you know, that inner voice. And Coelho said, oh, no, that inner voice is lying to you. And I went, what the heck? But what he said is there's this liar within us, and it's based on things that people have told us. It's based on the rejections that we've gone through, the experiences that we have, and it starts telling us that we're not worthy of being loved. That's the biggest lie of all. Because the secret isn't what's out there coming into you, but the secret is realizing that I am love. And it doesn't matter if it's coming back to me, it's already here. And all I have to do is I have to put it out there. And do I get hurt? Oh yeah, guess what? Would I get hurt if I didn't do that? Oh yeah, guess what? That's part of life. But it really frees you up to being able to connect with other people when you realize it's not about what you're getting from it, but what you can give to other people. But that inner voice, it tells us, don't love, you're going to get hurt. Don't love, they're going to reject you. You're not worthy of happiness. You're not worthy of that job, you know, and it's not until we, and it gets really loud. It screams in our ears, and it gets where it's really, really hard to not hear it. But the true voice of who we are is a quiet whisper that's within us. And in order to hear it, we have to find a place where we can have that quiet and listen to that whisper. And I think that's why nature is such a big thing to me, because, you know, I stand out there on the prairie and maybe the wind's blowing, maybe the coyotes are howling, but it's still a lot more quiet than what goes on in my head if I don't take that moment to do that. It's a wonderful thing. It's a wonderful thing. So, there you go. Phil, the philosopher, the lover of horses, yes. Any other questions, comments, concerns, criticism? Okay, well, I have some posters up here if anybody's interested. I'm happy to sign them. They're $5 each. I have some copies of my book. It's $15. I'll be happy to sign it. And thank you for coming. You don't have to buy it, you guys, you know, but it'd be nice if you did. Thank you.